Grade 12, Pre-Calculus, Day 18, Unit B, Trigonometry. So let's start by you reading pages 10 to 12. It's all actually word for word, copied verbatim from the Grade 11 stuff. So let's spend another hour or two just reviewing all of Grade 11. All right, so remember how to make angles? Here's how you make angles. Always measure angles from the positive x-axis counterclockwise, not like a navigator, not like a compass, right? If you're used to reading a GPS and a compass, we don't do it that way. We don't start at the top and go clockwise. We actually start at east and go counterclockwise, right? So if you happen to be a navigator or a snowmobiler or whatever, that's not the way we do it. And we use lots of other different angles, right? There's alpha and there's beta and there's theta. We use Greek letters very often. Right, next slide. All right, this looks kind of busy. So let's graph these places here. Let's see if you know where to graph a 30. So 30 degrees, good way to see if you know how to use a protractor. There's 120 degrees. There's 150. And where would 180 be? Well, that's halfway around the circle, so straight off to the left. Where's 240? Well, that's going to be, 210 rather. That's going to be an extra 30 past 180. So right about there, 210. How about 240 degrees? Well, that's going to be 60 past 180. So about there. So two slices of pizza, I guess, if you're doing 30 degree slices. So how about negative 60? Oh, negative 60 means you went backwards. Oh, I'm sorry, there's 315. Negative 60 means you go backwards 60 degrees. And 405, well, 405 means you went around once, and then you went around a bit more. So you went around one whole revolution, and then, boop, that extra 45 on top of it. So that's 405. Nobody says you got to stop after once around the Ferris wheel. You're allowed to go around a few times. And then 765, well, that's going to be around once. That's 360. Around twice is 720. And then another 45 would be 765, boom. And hey, it's the same as 45. You end up at the same spot. They're called coterminal. And here comes negative 150. So negative 150 goes backwards. So clockwise is your negative angles. So you got all that east. There you go. And what quadrant are things in? All right, you can fill this in. This is old news. Quadrant 1, all the X's and Y's are positive. Quadrant 2, all your X's are negative. In other words, your X's are less than 0, and all your Y's are bigger than 0. Quadrant 3, X's are negative and the Y's are negative. Negative, in other words, less than 0. Negative for the Y's, in other words, less than 0. And quadrant 4, the X's are back on the positive side again, so they're more than 0, and the Y's are less than 0. And what quadrant are you in for each of these? All right, can you picture them? Shout them out. So just making sure you know how to read your quadrants. It's a lot easier to direct your attention to something if I say, check out quadrant 1. And here you're going to go backwards 30. So backwards 30 puts you in quadrant 4. Backwards 120 backs you into quadrant 3. Kind of simple, eh? So that was grade 11 stuff, but we're just redoing it all over again just so there's no doubt. Polar coordinates. So now instead of saying how many blocks to the right you are and how many blocks up you are in the city, we're just going to give an angle and a distance. So an angle and a distance from Portage and Maine, or a radius, I suppose, is what I should have called it. So instead of X's and Y's, we're going to do radiuses, distances, and angles. Right? Distances and angles. Let's put it, interchange those, I suppose. And hopefully remember how to do the tangent. Right, so we calculate the distance by going Pythagoras, 6 squared, 8 squared is 100, square root of that is 10, so we know that's a 10. Well, it's really a 3, 4, 5 doubled up. And remember how to do the tangent of the angle? Well, the tangent is the opposite over the adjacent, so it's going to be the 6 over the 8. So you're going to untan that. Remember how to untan something, the inverse tan? And you'll find out it's 36.87 degrees right there. Now, technically speaking, I suppose I should fix this up here, but technically, let me see. Usually when we do these things, I should ungroup it. Normally we do r theta, not theta r. All right. So normally we say the distance and the bearing. R theta. There you go. There's the normal way we do polar coordinates, the distance and the angle. Where is it? Next slide. Let's do this one. Reference angle. So remember from grade 11, reference angle is this inside angle that our ancestors would do. See, our ancestors only understood triangles. So all their angles were always positive. They didn't understand you could go backwards around a wheel. In fact, they didn't even measure the same place as we did. They always measured the inside corner of a triangle, our ancestors. We learned to start measuring from one place and then come around. So, if I said that was 150, our ancestors would say, well, it's really just 8. Yeah, we're both saying the same thing. It's just we're starting to measure from over here and then we come around. And they're, instead of us, we're saying we're 150 from the right, and they're saying, well, you're just 30 up from the left. And guess what? We have negative angles, and they don't. So if I said this was 320, they would say, well, why would you call that 320? It's really just a 40 below. So our ancestors would say, it's a 40-degree triangle, they'd say. So the reference angle is always a positive angle that's less than 90. We measure it to the nearest x-axis. So what are the reference angles for these? 162. Well, let's see, if we were measuring 162 around here, our ancestors would say, well, it's just a triangle. It's only 18 away from that x-axis. So they would say it was 18. If we were going 321, because we always start over here and go all the way around, they'd say, well, why'd you do that? Why don't you just call it 39 right there? So they'd just call it a 39-degree angle. And 30, at least we agree in quadrant 1. In quadrant 1, we both agree that 37 is the answer. So there's no arguments in quadrant 1. All right, let's do some of this. Give you a chance to read it. Hit pause if you have to. And we've done lots of this in grade 11, too. So if you were said you were 6 blocks to the left and 6 blocks up, and I said, so what's your distance and your angle? Well, you'd say your distance was, well, you do a little bit of fancy math, and it doesn't matter that it's negative, because when you square a negative, you get a positive anyways. So you'd say it's 6 root 2s. And you'd measure the angle, well, at least the reference angle, because don't forget, your stupid calculator only understands certain angles. It doesn't understand our angles. It only understands reference angles. So you'd calculate the inverse tan of 6/6 is, well, that's the inverse tan of 1. Right? The inverse tan of 1 is 45, right? So our ancestors say that's a 45-degree angle, but we would say, well, we don't measure from there. We measure from here. We always measure from the same spot. See, sometimes they measure from this side, sometimes they measure down from this side, so they measure from all different places. We have one place to measure from, then there's no ambiguity. So it turns out we would call it 135, and our ancestors would call it 45. How about negative 4 comma negative 3? Let's calculate the distance. It's obviously a 3, 4, 5 triangle. And you know what? You didn't even really need the negatives in there, because when you square a negative, it's positive anyway. So the theta f is going to be, let's see, the inverse tangent to 3/4. Right? That would be your opposite, your adjacent. Opposite and adjacent, the way our ancestors thought about it. So the theta f is going to be 36.9 degrees. But of course, we don't do that. We would say, well, it's really 180 plus that extra 36.9. We'd say it's 216.9. Because we always measure from here. We don't just go to the nearest whatever makes us happy. And how about this one? So the distance, or the radius, I should probably have called it, is square root of 130. Don't try to tell me that it's something silly like 11 and a bit, because I won't buy it. It's the square root of 130. So you get the calculator to tell you kind of roughly what the answer is. Calculator, when you do the inverse tan, will tell you it's 37.87 degrees or so. It'll never be exact, of course. Oh. And that's the quadrant where we agree, right? We agree with that one. So when you're working in quadrant one, the reference angle is the same as the angle that we work with. Let's try this one. 9, negative 2. So the radius, or the distance, is 85, square root of 85, rather. And you can't fix that up any. There's no perfect squares in an 85 that I can tell. So the theta ref is going to be, let's see, opposite over adjacent, the inverse tan of 2 over 9. And it doesn't matter that it's a negative 2, because you know what? It's really a negative 2, but since our ancestors only understood, you can't have a negative-sided triangle, so our ancestors would have just said, what are you talking about, a negative-sided triangle? They wouldn't, they'd say we were nuts. They didn't even have negative numbers back then. Not until bankers came along. Right? So there you go. So nowadays, we've learned to call it, that position there would be 347.5 degrees, because we always measure starting from the x-axis and then go around this direction. See, they started at the x-axis and went backwards, and they didn't care that it was negative as far as we were concerned. So principal angles, try this on your calculator. The sine of 150 is 0.5. So, obviously, if I say, well, then undo that by doing the inverse sine, it should come up with the same answer. And you go, no. It says that it's, doesn't say it's 150, it says it's 30. Well, hold on. You said the sine of 150 is 0.5, and then you said, so what angle has a sine of 0.5? Obviously, it's 150, but the calculator says it's 30. Uh-oh. The heck? Let's try this. Let's try the cosine of 60. And your calculator is going to say it's 0.5. So then you do the inverse cos. So if you uncos the 0.5 to turn it back into the angle, well, it'll say it's 60. Oh, good, it works for that one. All right, let's do the cos of 210. Cos of 210 degrees, I think you'll find, is going to be negative 0.866. And then I say, okay, so uncos the 0.866 and turn it back into 210, please. So we know how to do inverse functions. That's what turns it back into what you started with. So if we uncos it, we should end up with 210. And it goes, no, you don't. It says you end up with 150. And you go, oh, my brain hurts. Well, it turns out you're smarter than your calculator. It turns out your calculator doesn't understand that. Your calculator only gives you certain values. Right? So for now, it's important you realize that the calculator only knows one particular answer. It doesn't know all the possible answers. So the calculator's kind of limited. You have to then go in and help the calculator figure out what you really wanted to know. All right, so we bypass this one for now. Get ready to advance. Ready now. And we bypass this for now. We'll come back. Ready now. And here, we'll look at this unit circle. So check out our unit circle. This is a unit circle. It has a radius of 1 unit. Right? 0.2, 0.4, 0.6, 0.8, all the way over to here is one unit. So we're going to learn how to use this unit circle well, a lot. Okay, it's going to be your bread and butter for this entire unit. Next slide. So I recall we did this back in grade 11, but we'll do it again. If I said, what is the sine of 45? Well, you could take a protractor, measure a 45 degree angle. Notice this is a unit circle, so the radius is 1. So you'd count up, how high up am I? 0.1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. You'd say, oh, look, I'm 0.7 up. So when I'm there, on that dot, on that point, I'm 0.7 of the way up. And it turns out that the sine of 45 is 0.7. So when you're doing a sine, you're really just measuring how high up you are on a Ferris wheel. Let's try it for this. All right, I gave you some Planck template here. What's the sine of 150 degrees? Well, draw it in there with a protractor, or unless you're really good at eyeballing it. I started to eyeball them, and I was getting pretty close. So there'd be 150 degrees. How high up are you? Well, let's see. It looks to me like you're halfway up. Look, 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4. You're 0.5 up, so that length there is the same as that length there, because it's a triangle, so it's really just half that rectangle, so it's 0.5. What's the sine of 225? So here's 225 here. So I think you'll find the sine of 225 is really, let's see, 0.1, 0.7, about 0.7 down. So negative 0.7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, and if you check it with a calculator, I think the calculator says it's 7071 or something. So you can actually get the answer pretty close just by looking at a circle, a unit circle especially. Let's try it some more since this is so fun. What's the sine of 300 degrees? Let's see, 300's down there. So it looks to me like you're 0.1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Oh, 0.8, almost 0.9, 0.87 or so. So what's the y? How much is your up and down on there? What's the y of that point? Looks like it's almost 0.9, 0.87 or so. Let's see, come across here. I'm thinking it's 0.87, 0.88. What's the real value here? 0.87. Hey, it's really 0.866 on the calculator. What's the y? Oh, so what's the cosine of 300? So it turns out, guess what? If the y, if your up and down is your sine, then your left and right is your cosine. Sneaky, eh? Watch this. So I'm going to say the cosine of this 300 degrees is, let's see, if I went around 300 degrees, I'd be, look at this, how much to the right am I? 1, 2, 3, 0.5. I'm halfway to the right. So if I'm halfway to the right, 0.5 to the right on a unit circle, I'm thinking that should be 0.5. And if you do it on your calculator, it says that it is 0.5. So it turns out that sine is really the y over the, well, it's really the opposite over the hypotenuse, which of course you know is the y over the 1, because we conveniently made this a unit radius 1 circle, because we're so good at dividing by 1. So that's why we made it a unit circle, because when you divide it by the hypotenuse, or the radius that is, I'm sorry, you don't have to divide because it's a 1. So it turns out your height is really just your y, and your left and right is really just your x, so your sine is your y, and your cosine is your x of your point when you're going around the Ferris wheel. Let's do some more. What's the sine of 140 degrees and the cosine of 140 degrees? You can almost start to do these in your head. So I just eyeballed this one. I didn't take out a protractor. So I said the sine of 140, and I just drew it in there. And I went, let's see, it looks like I'm how far up? Let's see, 0.1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 0.63, 0.64 maybe. And the real answer is I think the real answer was 0.64. So I was off by a penny. Sorry about that. And what's my x? How far to the left am I? So I went 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, almost 8. So I'd sort of guess at 0.78-ish. And I think, negative 0.78. And I think the real answer was negative 0.77 or something. Whatever. The fact is you can sort of see the answers in your head. And here's some more. We'll just let this run silently. It's the same thing over and over again. And, of course, if you check out your blue sheet, you'll see some of these answers on there. On your blue sheet, I give you a big unit circle and some of the primary angles. So maybe you realize now that you can almost start to do them in your head. You don't really need it. And it's kind of handy to be able to have a rough idea what the answer is, even if you're not quite as accurate as what we're doing here. Because when the calculator spits out an answer, you should at least know whether it's close or not. So why is the sine of 210 degrees the same as the sine of 330? Well, here's the sine. There's sine of 210 right there. Right? That's your y, how far below you are at 210. And let's check out 330. Well, look, you're the same distance below. There you go. Because it is the same triangle, isn't it? That's the same length as that. That's 1, and that's 1. They're both the same radius. So that's 1, and that's 1. And that's a square corner, and that's a square corner. And so if that's the same corner as that, and that radius is the same as that, and if this is 30 below 180, and this is 30 here, that's 30 below 0, then that corner is the same as that corner, and this corner is the same as this corner, and this length is the same as this length. If three parts of a triangle are all, of two different triangles are congruent, then the triangles must be the same triangle. So that means this is the same as this too then. It's called triangle congruency, if you remember doing some of that. I think only the grade 11 applied does that. Maybe we'll do some of that. All right, so this is kind of nasty. Oh, this one's all right. So we skipped ahead a few bits because I wanted to show you the meaty bits here. All right, so let's look at how you solve something like this. All right, so the first thing to do is say, well, I don't know how to do that. So then turn it into something you do know how to solve that's similar. That's one of the secrets. There's about 12 ways to solve problems. One of the ways is if you don't understand a problem, turn it into something that's similar and solve that problem. So do you agree this is sort of the same? Here's an unknown, a bunch of stuff, and here's an unknown bunch of stuff. So that's like grade 8 up here. So you go like that, the answer ends up being x is 1/2. Good. So if you know how to do that, well then, you must know how to do this, because we'll do the same steps. Alright, so we'll get rid of that. Subtract 5 by adding 5. So we'll divide both sides by 4. Boom. So now there's your answer. The cosine of the angle is 1/2. And you go, well, what's the answer then? Because there's the cosine of the answer is 1/2. So you draw yourself a pretty little picture or get out your calculator. So where is my pencil halfway to the right when I put it there and start rotating it around? So I started rotating my pencil around, and I got to there. And I went, okay, so what is that? And the calculator told us that that was a 60-degree angle. So I wanted to know when was my cosine equal to 1/2. And the plastic brain told us that it's 60 degrees. Now you got to be smart enough to know that there's another place. Oh, so let's just check our answer here first. So check the 60 to make sure that we're good. Because if that was messed up, then the other one will be messed up, too. So it did work. Yep. So it works. Tick, tick. Happy face. But there's another answer. Where else are you halfway to the right? Well, you could be. Here's you on the dot. You could be halfway to the right when you're above on the right, or you could be halfway to the right when you're below and to the right in quadrant 4. Ah, so it turns out that you could be there too, so there was two answers. Notice that's a 90 degree corner, that's a 90 degree corner. This is a length 1, this is a length 1. And notice that we said that this was the same length as this, so they're both a half there. So it's two of the exact same triangles, so obviously that's got to be 60 as well. So 60 below and 60 above would put you halfway to the right. So that answer is 300 degrees. So let's try that one. Just check that answer. Plug in a 300 and see if it gives you the same answer. Yeah, it does. So two of those answers worked. There was two answers to that, 60 and 300. But your plastic brain only knew that one because it only knows the principal answers. It doesn't know that there's another place where you're halfway to the right on a Ferris wheel. Now, this one was kind of mean, so I'll just accelerate it. So disregard this one. Oh, well, at least you'll see the type of thing that's coming at you then. Turns out the tan's an odd function, so the other answer's just over there as well. So if that's 61, that's 61, so the other answer's 151. There you go. But that was mean. Don't worry about that one. So disregard this one, and here, so get into your trig review. There, I'll be coming around to make sure they're done. This was the thing that we handed out in grade 11, and make sure it's done because we got a thunder on. We got lots more to learn. And somebody asked me about what's an inverse cos after class, so I said, well, here you go. Here's a cosine. You're pretty good at cosigning things by hitting the cosine button on your calculator. Cos of 30 is 0.866. Cos of 60 is, well, that's 1/2. All right, so now if I gave you the cosine and asked you what the angle was, that would be called inverse cosing. So when you go this way, you're going inverse cos. So when you go this way, when you take an angle and turn it into a ratio or a decimal, that's called a cosine. And when you take the ratio and turn it back into the angle that tells you that trigonometric, that was that trigonometric ratio, when you turn it into degrees, that's called the inverse cos. So just like square and square root undo each other, that's the same thing. So try this. Do the inverse cos of a cos. Well, the inverse cos of a cos is really just going to be what you started with, isn't it? So it's like saying the square root of a square, or the square of a square root, rather. Or it's just like saying the quotient of a product, or something like that, right? If I multiply by and divide by 2, same thing. So why would you do the quotient of a product when you wasted your time, right? Why would you, right? So why would you inverse cos a cos? And we'll be starting this stuff tomorrow. And somebody asked me about radians, so here's what that was all about. Radians. We'll be learning this pretty soon, too. How many radians are around the circle? Alright, so that took care of all of that stuff. And the army uses mils, because 1,000 mils is, well, pretty close to 1,000. 2 pi r's. Okay, so there you go. Briefing is complete.